everybody. How are you? Got a bunch of information. Now, the title of this is Packet Tracers for the PhDs. I will be explaining in a little bit. Hang on. All right. First, I got good news. All right. As you can see at the bottom, I got a little ticker going there. There's a coupon code that you can use in GlobeEd. It's called Eclipse. Like the Eclipse we just had, Eclipse. You get 90% off all self-paced courses for the next 72 hours. So if you go to GlobeEd.net, let me show it to you here. You go to GlobeEd.net, you see my courses here. Any one of these courses, where you're gonna get, you get 90% off all these courses. Yes, all of them, even this one. All of them. So you go there, you pick and choose, all right? And then you can get 90% off whichever ones that you want. If you're doing your CCNA, take advantage of the CCNA boot camps that I have here. These are four-hour videos for the whole time I was there. And then, or you just want the actual boot camps. So you got the NRC boot camp. You got other self-paced courses. So everything there that you see on GlobeEd, it's 90% off for the next 72 hours. So take advantage of it, okay? Use the coupon code Eclipse. Eclipse. All right. That out of the way. Howdy, howdy, Don. All right. Now, that out of the way, one of the things that the name of this particular video, Packet Tracer should be open. There it is. Okay. This is a Packet Tracer for the PhD. What does that mean? All right. Colleges, this is to you. Colleges, universities, I'm not even going to say technical schools because these are IT individuals that work there, okay? So they know how to use it. But I've been noticing that quite a bit, if not all colleges, the teachers, professors, whatever they want to call themselves, I said PhD, so doctors that are working there, okay, in the networking realm, what are you doing? First of all, the Packet Tracer is very low curve. Cisco, this is a free software. Let me back up. This is a free application. I want to show it to you right here. Okay, this is the Packet Tracer right here. Isn't it lovely? Okay, it's right here. You got menu bars, toolbars. You got all sorts of things, work areas. You got all sorts of routers. The Packet Tracer, for being free, does a lot of things. Okay, so what do you college professors need to do? Okay, thank you, Mr. Don. I appreciate that. Thank you. One of the things that you need, these colleges and universities, they are accredited, they're teaching networking. First of all, it's free. You go to cisco.com, you register as a user, right? You get a username and password, an account at cisco.com. You search to download the Packet Tracer. It'll take you to the Net Academy. And you can even go through a course in the Networking Academy for free, okay, that will show you how to use it. But I'm going to give you a very quick, basic example, because what I've been seeing coming from colleges, labs that they're giving their students, it is friggin' hilarious. It is insane. No wonder these students are completely confused. It just doesn't even make sense. All right. I don't know what you're doing. And if you're actually typing the instructions, you need to have an English major type it for you. I don't know how you wrote your thesis, but hey, we got ChatGPT. You know, tell ChatGPT what you want because your instructions are all over the place. So let me show you something real quick. Okay. Let me go there. So here, now, one of the things, and I'm not telling you how to teach, obviously. I mean, you have a PhD, you should know how. Depending on the router that you're using, it'll depend on the features that will be available to you. Now, I personally like to use a 2911 router. And before we get into that, that's kind of, you know, internal there. There's a help button on here. It says help, and then it says about. If you're running, and that says 8.21, if you're running anything less than that, you're out of get. You're not up to date. For those of you, let me put my face in here because it's upsetting. For those of you that are running 6.2 and telling your students that you can't save, telling your students that you know you can only one, it can be installed only on one computer, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? You're screwing everything up. All right. You're wrong. Okay. It's a free software. Every student, every individual in the world that wants to get Cisco certified or at least Network Plus and CCNA, and they don't have the resources, right, to buy the actual devices or invest in GNS3 or invest in EVNG or CML2 or Boson, they can download the Packet Tracer, which is a free application, okay, a free simulator. Every individual in the world, all you got to do is create that user account. Go download the Packet Tracer and then take the course if you want to, or just play with it. You'll learn how to do it. So let me bring out a switch. We're going to make this real simple. Okay, let me bring out a switch, and I hope you can see this here. No, because you're looking at my ball head right here. And let me zoom in. Am I zooming in? Well, let me do it this way. There we go. So we got a switch. Let me zoom in one more time. There we go. All right, so we got a switch and a router. Now, one of the things that you need to understand is that in the menu bar, you have an options, right? You got file, edit, and options. So when you click on options, the first line beneath that is called preferences, and it has an ellipsis. For you PhDs that don't understand what an ellipsis is, it's three little dots. That means you have more options, okay? So you click on that, and look, more options. Now, I know this may be hard to see, but in the first tab, these up here are called tabs, just so you know. All right. Again, this is directed because I know that my students, IT individuals, that you know, I have just on one platform, I have over 137,000 students, and I'm in 40 different platforms. Okay. They know. I just want to make sure that you PhDs and colleges and universities understand this. These are called tabs. Okay. And these are the things that you can do within each tab. So in the tab that says interface, if you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it says always show port labels in logical workspace. This is your logical workspace, right? This white area you see back here, it says logical and physical. All right, we're in the logical. That's why it's highlighted blue. So you want to click, turn that on, put a check mark in there. Why do you want to do that? Because when you connect something, you're going to go to the lightning bolt. Now, this is a switch. This is a router. These are dissimilar devices. You're going to use a straight through, right? And I'm going to click, and I'm going to say, let's say I normally myself, Lazaro J. Diaz, I click, let's say, fast Ethernet 24, higher end port, and I go to the router and I go gig 00, right? But why do you want to click? Because you want to see where you're connecting to. This is what I've been seeing that these PhDs are doing. F0/24. They're creating labels or place notes for interfaces because this is what they do, or they don't do, I should say. They leave the default settings in the Packet Tracer that shows no interfaces, and then they put this on top of it. No. Because people that have been using the Packet Tracer for decades understand that the Packet Tracer, when you have a big network, everything just piles up on each other. And then you're adding labels to it for the interfaces? Yes, don't do that, please. That shows the lack of knowledge that you have using the Packet Tracer. So again, go to options, preferences. Go to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th option, which says always show port labels. Click on it, and lo and behold, now you know what you're connecting to. Now, with the package ratio, you got to be careful because things, if you put them too close together, you don't know what's what. So you got to make sure that you separate it. Now, if you are writing things, please make sure that you are specific in what you want to do, okay? In what you want to do. So again, with the packet tracer, make sure, more very important, so you don't have to create 3 million labels, please check that off. And then so students know what they're connecting to, where they should put an IP address. There's no need to create a label. Now, if you want to create a place note or label, of course, you don't need to give the actual IP address. If you're teaching IP addressing, and listen, I understand if you, you know, if you're instructors in colleges, whatever you call yourselves, that you don't under, you don't know how to subnet. I get it. I get it. That's the hardest subject there is in IT, but I wrote a book on it. My method is the easiest method. And a lot of colleges are trying to use it. But again, it's a person in the front of the classroom that just doesn't get it. So for the students, it's just a much easier. Well, I'm sorry. I'll do what I normally do. Well, no, this is for a LAN. So let's say it's 192.168.1.0/24. So that's what you do. So student, and you put it right here in the middle. Okay. So you say, okay, this is the 120. This is the 1.0 network 24. So I have 254 IP addresses available to me. So if you click and you decide you want to put a computer, and let me show you when I connect N devices. Okay. Again, I get my lightning bolt. And then I click a straight through cable, and then I click on the device, 5610 to F01. I use LoRa ports, but you see what I'm saying? You see how that F01 and F00 down here, you see how it's on top of each other? You want to make sure that when you hand these labs to these students, at least give the instructions, hey, listen, you're going to have to start breaking things apart. Or if you're going to give them instructions, all right, you need to make sure that they're very detailed, because if you are giving, I don't give instructions. I tell them I need connectivity here. You need to configure the rip routing protocol, ESRP, multiple OSPF, whatever it is. This is your network ID, and I allow the students, as I teach subnetting. Okay, I know how I know that. I actually wrote the book on it. Okay, so they know what to put. And for the life of me, I do not understand this right here. I don't know, just an IP address willy-nilly. 105.264.183. No, let's bid it 28, let's say, whatever. Why would you do something like that? Why would you do so? Are you teaching them to write numbers? Are you, they need to understand the concept of what their gateway is, right? Or the IP addresses on a point-to-point connection. Why are you making these freaking numbers that you got to keep looking at it to memorize what they are? Make it simple. You heard that saying, right? You got to kiss it. All right. You got to kiss it so people can understand. Because with this right here, this example, in my method, everybody knows, oh, 1.0, yeah, well, Laz, he's going to go to the desktop. And why do I see people going here? Why? Why do I see people going into the config tab? And some of you even close this out, but it's funny because I'm going to talk about that too. Why? No, you go to the desktop. You go to the IP configuration. You go to IPv4.192.168.1.1. Why are we using 1.1 as gateway? Not that you can't, but you're doing it because Microsoft does it. I don't want to use that. I want to use lower IP addresses, because one thing in a network, when you're configuring, especially when you're labbing, trying to learn a concept, okay, you need to understand what it is that you're doing. All right, so For me, lower IP addresses, say from 60.192.168.1.60 and below, will be end devices. Anything higher, or maybe from 100 or from 150 and down, okay, or whatever. The lower IP addresses will be for end devices, okay, and higher IP addresses will be for switches and routers. And then you click here, it's a default mask, that's fine. And then my gateway will be 192.168.1.1. 1.254, right? So that's what I would put. And then that's that. So you know what your gateway should be. My last available IP address, let me get my face in here so you can see my expression and how passionate I am about this. So my first available IP addresses will always be for my host, or if it's a server or whatever. You assign 1.2.3.4, right? And then you, for your routers, right? For, let's say, for the gateway, which is this, well, you can't see it. It's the G00 interface. It would be the last available IP address. Your gateway will be the last available IP address. That way, in your mind, the student knows how to get across. Laz, I would like to do CCNP on your page. However, I just saw NRC, and it's not the complete course. Please advise. I shall do so, sir. I shall do so. On Global, what do you mean it's not the complete course? What do you mean it's not? What's missing on it? Tell me what's missing. If I have your email, if you can send me your email or email me at, excuse me, at info@globet.net, so we can go back and forth. info@globet.net, excuse me. All right, so we can talk about that. All right, so the last available IP address is your gateway. All right, that way they know wherever land they go to, that IP address will be that. You do not have to follow the Microsoft standard. Well, .1 is your gateway, and from 2 to 11 is the servers, and then from, no, it's a private IP addressing scheme. Your gateway can be whatever the hell you want it to be. Okay, I think the most difficult part for students is friggin' understanding the comical lab that you guys that are teaching in these mainstream colleges are doing. It really is. It's a friggin' farce. Also, choose what. Also, whoever's connecting to Ethernet 0 or Ethernet, you're using Ethernet ports here. You see, we have fast Ethernet. Okay, why are we connecting to Ethernet ports? Excuse me. Why are we doing that? Anybody teaching? Oh my God. Excuse me. I'm so sorry. Anybody teaching Cisco, CCNA, all right? Especially CCNA, right? Cisco. Really? E0 Ethernet? We don't do 10 megabits per second anymore, okay? Minimum is fast Ethernet. So why are you doing that? Also, why are you putting hubs in your labs? Is it like, what? Nobody uses hubs. It's good history lesson. Well, you know, we came from using hubs and repeaters with the, what is it, 5-4-3-2-1 rule and all this stuff. That's cool to know and understand topologies and stuff like that. But when you give them a lab, right, with very, you know, with little to no or very confusing instructions, that's crazy. And then with a packet tracer, that just doesn't even make any sense. And also, if you weren't aware, PhDs, that the packet tracer lies to you. Did you know that? Packet tracer is full of bugs, which is a good thing. That way you can troubleshoot, because similar devices cross over cable, dissimilar devices straight through cable. And that's where you see in the packet tracer. Let me show you the screen again. In the packet tracer down here, the black dashed line, that's a crossover. The solid black line is a straight through. All right. I've seen certain labs coming from these colleges that have straight through cables from switch to switch or PC to router, which is not the case. Even though the light turns green, doesn't mean it's okay. It's wrong. It's wrong. So please put the right cabling, okay? And if you're using serial, okay, no, did you explain that the clock rates need to be on there? Is this something that you did? No, you didn't, all right? Because I do my own one-on-one tutoring, okay? And I see college students' labs, okay? On my own, my platform, globeed.net, I do one-on-one tutoring, and I see these students coming from major colleges with their labs that are like, what in the world is this? And you're going back and forth. And here we go again. Let me put my face back in it. There's something called housekeeping. At least that's what I call it. That's what they used to call it. Okay. You need to get it straight. What do you want people to do first? How about giving a host name to your router? Why are you creating usernames that are insanely complex? Are you trying to just confuse the hell out of them? Okay. Because it doesn't make any sense that you would do something like that. Or you do like a gotcha moment. I use this symbol, not that symbol. Let me give you a check minus. What? Remember your goal, your objective. And I'm being serious, okay? I'm being very serious, okay? I have a bachelor's. I don't have a master's. I don't want it. I don't want a PhD. I don't want it, especially in what I do, okay? Because it seems to me that lately, the higher you go, I don't know, maybe you get mad, you're burned out from all the writing and reading and all that stuff. Even though that doesn't matter nowadays, that writing, reading, and arithmetic, you know how it is nowadays. Okay, so please learn to use the packet tracer accordingly. Okay, and I know something all of you love to use. Let me show you this. I find this hilarious. Because you're trying to make these elaborate labs and all you're doing is confusing the hell out of your students. So what happens is they'll get out, let's say, I'm just going to do a simple example. I'll put two 2011 routers here. Oh, and for goodness sake, don't do this. Don't do that. Don't connect your routers like that and then put a label on them. Don't do that. Okay? That's just not. Ooh. You don't want to do that. Okay. If you're going to connect the routers, actually connect them, please. All right. And look, these are two routers. So these are similar devices. Therefore, you would need a crossover cable. And listen, if you don't know, that's what this lightning bolt here is for, where you can go ahead and click on it and you can go boom, boom, and it does it on your own. Okay. There you go. And the only downside to doing it that way is the fact that it'll choose the first available open port to do that, so you don't choose the port. So but you can do that, but this is why I like it when they do stuff like this. They select these two and they come up here. Is it up here? Where is it at? Where's the cluster? Because I don't use that entire workspace, new workspace. Where is this? Is it up here? Window extension, where's the cluster tools? Here you go. Is it this? No, here it is. Here it is, right here. It's on this side. Boom. And they do this. And they put these two together. And then they lock it. And then they don't give you the information as to what IP address is what. Although they'll do something, a label here, and they'll put an IP address on this. So you know what to put over here. Don't do that. You don't have to create a humongous network to make that happen. Okay, you do not have to do that. You do not. I mean, how do you get rid of this thing? I don't want to cluster it. I want to decluster it. How do you get rid of it? No, I don't know. And I really don't care, to be honest with you, because I don't do this. This is nonsense. You're making these labs so big that it doesn't even make any kind of sense, okay? So don't do that. Don't do that at all, okay? Go back one level. No, how do you uncluster this damn thing? Okay, I don't know. Let me see, can I right click it? No, I don't know. Anyway, so now we have two things here as well. We have the logical and we have the physical. The physical, actually, if you go into the intercity here, we can click on here and we can actually go into the rack. Now I've seen certain instructors do that, and this is awesome. And they make their students, I understand why, they make their students configure their entire network here. And this is cool. You see how neat this is? This is awesome because this is the reality of it when they get out there in the workforce. So I know why they do it, but this is the problem, PhDs. If you do everything from the physical side, the logical side will be a mess. With everything on the logical side, everything looks all pretty here, doesn't it? But if I decide that I want to bring a server into the rack and put it right underneath this router right there, okay? How does it look in the logical side? Hey, where's the server? Let's zoom out. Oh, there's a server. Did you see it? It just puts it wherever. So you work on the logical side and the physical side will get done. And again, you could use, oh, that's another thing that you may not know, in the physical part, if you have the slots for it, you can have multi-home servers, right? You can get rid of this slot and put one that has multiple NIC cards and you a multi-home server, or and then connect it to two different devices. You can do all that stuff. But the first thing that you need to teach your students is the concepts of the stuff that you're teaching, okay? Which is obviously we start with the OSI model, Cisco three-layer model, TCP/IP model, topologies, right? Star, ring, bus, hybrid, CSMA, CD, things of that nature. But the packet tracer, if you're having issues understanding your PhDs and students alike, okay, when you download, when you go to Cisco and you create that user account, right, there's a course for free in Cisco, right, in the Net Academy, they can take for 2 hours. I think there's longer ones. And it teaches you how to navigate completely through the packet tracer, okay? How to put in devices, take out devices. And just so you know, students, and obviously your professors, when you install the packet tracer in the C drive, it's a folder in the C, I think it's in the downloads folder, there's labs already there. There's already labs there with instructions on what you to, you know, let's say it's Radius. You're doing security, you're doing Radius. The instructions are right there. They show you how to do it. And one cool item within that options, when we go to options preferences, and within that first tab, the interface tab right there, in the bottom, there's an export button. That export button exports a log of everything you've done in that packet tracer since the moment you started, okay? For that day, once you close it, it's over, all right? But everything you've done in the switch, the router, everything will be in a notepad file. And you can save that to your desktop. So you can see you have a date stamp, time and date stamp on there, and it'll show you all the different prompts and things you typed to get to where you need to go, okay? So when you start learning these things, all right, you as a student, since, you know, you probably don't have that much help at school, that's why, you know, I'm here for you. That's why I do the one-on-one tutoring, because I know you need it. You have to make sure that you know how to use this particular simulator, because this is the beginning. This is the very beginning where, you know, the packet tracer make things easy. You got little lights that turn on green or red if you don't do a no-shut or things like that. Because once you get to GNS3, even G, or CML2, I don't know. I haven't used BOSS on, so I wouldn't know theirs. But the other three, there's no little lights. You need to go in there and type in the show IP in brief, take a look if it's up, down, administratively down. You need to do some work in order to make sure that everything is hunky-dory. I know that right now, everything is dashboard-driven with the Cisco DNA, and then, you know, we have dashboards, you know, dashing all the way, okay? And we've always used dashboards. That's just the way it is in IT, all right? But you need to know your CLI, because wake-up call, when you go take a certification, just because you pass your class in college doesn't mean you're Cisco certified. You pass the Cisco Network Academy. Believe me, that's hard. That's hard enough as it is. Those books are just rough, okay? On top of bad instruction. But you do need to go to Pearson View and sign up for the test. You sign up Pearson View. Hey, I want to take the CCMA 200-301. I want to go ahead and sign up for it. I don't know, cost $350, whatever it is, $400. I don't know right now. And then you set up the time, the location you're going to take these tests at. Okay. Then once you get that certification, then you're Cisco certified. Now when you pass the class at your school, all right? Hey, Laz. Hey, what's up, Roder? Hi, Laz. Are you studying for any cert currently? Yes, I am. I am studying for the Cisco Certified Design Experts, right? For the CCDE. I am studying for that right now. All right. It's not been easy, but I'm going through it. So that's what I'm doing right now. Let's see. I want to take it this year. I'll say that. Because I am doing a lot of things, but no excuse. This is the year that I want to get that because I do like design. And once you get to a point where you understand, because to do design, you need to understand the routing protocols, the devices, what are their purposes, where they should be at. Like, span tree is going away. But you need to understand layer 3, layer 2, all these different things, the firewalls, where should they be, things like that, the business aspect of it. So it's just not the technical side of it. There's a business side to it as well. So yeah, do you use INE? I'm not using INE right now. I just purchased the book. I'm reading right now, going through the different chapters. I'm just doing that. Just doing the reading. INE, I love INE. Okay, I do like INE. I used INE for when I got my CCIE written. I took the CCIE hands-on lab. That was kind of expensive though. That cost me their boot camp cost me $6,000. It was worth it though. It was worth it, I'll be honest with you. I have all the videos from back then for Blueprint 5. Okay. Have all the videos. We were there 12 hours a freaking day. Very knowledgeable individuals. These people can make routers dance. Okay. They knew everything because everything is troubleshooting. So I guess when I finished the CCDE, when I finish that, I mean, as far as the reading, I'll see where I'm at. And if I need something, I may go to them, all right, because they're the ones. If you want expert certifications, especially the lab portion of it, those are the only people that are going to teach it to you. I'm not even going to attempt that. INE are the only ones that can teach you the expert level hands-on, okay? Unless Kevin Wallace himself is going to teach you the CCIE or whatever expert level certification you're going to get, no. That would be the only other person that I will recommend. Okay. But as far as a company, yeah, INE, they're awesome. They're awesome. When it comes to their expert level certifications, they're on point. Big time. It's expensive, but hey, it's an investment. It's not like when you're going to college that you're paying, well, let's say you're paying about $120,000 every year. Not really. You're paying what? You're probably about $60,000 a year for 4 years. You come out of there with $240,000, if not more. And it's just because you had to take poetry, art, all these humanities that you don't really need. What's viral? Oh, viral. I call it V-I-R-L. It's viral. It's the first edition of CML2, right? It was called Viral. I call it Viral. All right. It's Cisco's emulator. All right. That Cisco created that for you to do that. You're not even employable after college. It's unfortunate, but it's true. You're not employable, period. Nowadays, in the past 3 years, it's been very difficult. And it's funny because in my workshop this past week, I talked, and we talked about this topic actually. Because we just don't do the workshop. We have, you know, we shoot back and forth things. And one of the things is, it's, you know, you got people that have certs. Some people have experience. Not maybe, you know, experience specifically in one thing. But if you understand the concepts, so let's say of a firewall. If you understand the concepts of a firewall, not every firewall is equal. Different navigations, routers. If you're going from the Juniper or Alcatel-Lucent, you're going to Cisco, you're going to F5, different Nokia, you're going to different routers, you're going to have a different type of navigation, just like going between operating systems. Just because you don't are not aware of the navigation doesn't mean that you can't learn it. You understand that what a routing protocol is, you understand what an IP address is, you should understand. And if you're going to do your due diligence, if you're going to go to an interview or whatever the case may be, you write all this down. You look for the PDFs, you look for the manuals, you look for the syntax, you look at the videos, you teach yourself how to do this. Because Alcatel-Lucent, when I was in telecommunications, right, they're the only ones that have Alcatel-Lucent schools. There are like 4 schools throughout the United States that actually had a class just on their stuff. Is there a Fortinet class? Is there a Juniper class? Is there a college that teaches all these different vendors? No, they don't. They teach Cisco. They teach Cisco, or they think they're teaching Cisco anyway. But they don't use these EVNG or GNS3 because it's not feasible for the college, even though you're paying tons of money or they can afford that. But they use the Packet Tracer, and then they tell students, well, it's not free. Yeah, it is. I tell my students, download it. Go to Cisco, make an account, download it, and friggin' put out there 5 routers, 5 switches, PCs, servers. You can do a whole bunch of stuff with the Packet Tracer and practice every single day. I know guys that finish college in cloud and networking and end up in help desk. That's fine. That's fine. That's fine. Listen, I think that every IT individual, I got hired at help desk, outsource help desk, the answer group tag. I don't know if they still exist or not. I worked there. Okay. That's fine that you work there. Okay. That's perfectly fine because you need to learn how to troubleshoot. You need to learn how to troubleshoot. That's a good place to start. Rahil, last, what are your thoughts on doing multiple jobs at once? In this topic, oh yeah, man, for sure, for sure. Unfortunately, that's what you got to do. Unfortunately, you got to do multiple stuff. You got to do multiple things. There's just if you have that possibility, then you have no choice but to do that. If you're lucky now with virtual, everybody's working virtual. Listen, my wife and my stepdaughter, their morning job is Globed and all the other platforms that I'm in, and my wife did all that promotion for Globed today and for my other platforms, and my stepdaughter has uploaded the videos and editing and all that, and then at night they work for a company that for ticketing, so they do that. So exactly, thank you, Router. Exactly, you got to do that. And listen, my mom, she worked 42 years, 2 jobs. We came to this country in 1973. She got hired 3 months after being here. And for 42 years, she worked 2 jobs. Full-time one, right? She was always at work at 7:30 in the morning, left at 5, went to the other job, got there by 6 o'clock. She didn't get home till 10. And she did that for all those years. No joke, okay? She did that. So unfortunately, even if it was, you know, back in a time where, but she wanted to make sure that we were okay. So unfortunately, that's just the way things are. I'm planning to get the CCNP course on Globed as soon as April 20th, 2024. What should I expect? It has been long overdue. I've been making plans, but I get a bit demotivated. I don't understand. As far as the CCNP core, if that's the one you're taking, The newer things, because, I mean, the routing protocols always are going to be there. The newer things will be doing route maps, conditional matching. We'll get into VXLAN, Lisp, talking about, describing. Because a lot of those advanced things with Lisp and VXLAN and all that, you're just basically understanding the controllers and all that. It's just understanding what the terminology is. We'll be doing multicasting. We'll be doing QoS. All these different things that you did partially in the CCNA, they just go a little bit further in the CCNP. There is a lot to the CCNP. I have my book right here.
This is the NRC, and then I got right here the core.
So right here. This is the core right here. I've been teaching this down since, my God, 2020, well, since it came out, really. You got your basic stuff, packet forwarding. You still got span tree, even though span tree is bye-bye. All right, span tree and MST. That's, you know, so we got span tree. We got routing essentials, static routing, path selection, EIGRP, which, again, it's ridiculous. This is what I love, VTP, which they took out of the CCNA. Don't use VTP. That says it in the CCNA. Don't use VTP because VTP is dangerous. Here's a whole chapter. Not a whole chapter, but a good chunk of a chapter. Well, it's three pages. I'm exaggerating. There's three pages of VTP and configurations. All right. OSPF, advanced OSPF, BGP, obviously. Now, yeah, that's where the conditional matching, route maps, filtering, that's where that starts. Communities, multicasting, right? You will be doing multicasting. Obviously, QoS, a lot deeper. Okay, QoS, a lot deeper. Then we get into HSRP, NAT, obviously ACLs, all that stuff, IPsec, GRE, LISP, like I said earlier, wireless. There's five chapters on wireless. Chapter 17, 18, 19, 20, and 21. Five chapters on wireless alone, okay? Then it's just network architecture, looking at a hierarchical design, okay? Fabric technologies, that's your SD access, SD-WAN, all that good stuff. Network assurance, security, okay? And they're mainly talking about the threat, Cisco Threat Grid, Talos, Cisco Umbrella, all that stuff. Network access control, 802.1x, EAP methods, they talk about EAP. And then we get into, obviously, chapter 26 is ACLs. Your terminal line protection, which is silly. Zone-based firewalls, which you can do in the packet tracer. AAA radius, right? Virtualization. Now, when it comes to this, I'm going to be honest with you, and even in my CCNA, when it comes to foundational network programmability concepts, okay, we will talk about what a northbound API is, what a southbound API is, but we're not going to do any programming whatsoever. I took my core last year, okay, the new one. I took it last year, okay? All you need to understand is what squiggly line goes where and what's the output going to look like. That's it. That's it when it comes to that. And then automation tools, agent-based automation tools, agentless, the EEM, that is, we will do labs on that, EEM. All right, and that's it. That's all there's to it. Just got to go through it. I've been through it a million times already, okay? And I took the certification last year, and believe me, I had plenty of time when I was done. It wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be, right? Because I did a lot of focusing on route maps. I thought, oh, they're going to kill me with the route maps and the conditional matching and all that stuff. So I got to make sure I get that squared away. It wasn't that bad. Point is, you know, I came out here wanting to tell you about what's going on in GlobeEd, but the title of this, what I'm noticing in these colleges right now is that, you know, you got people paying thousands upon thousands of dollars, whether it's through financial aid, a loan, if it's a veteran, right? VA benefits, whatever the case may be. You know, I mean, hopefully you don't have to pay this thing back. It's something that's already, you've already paid through because you paid into it, whatever the case may be. But some people are getting out of college with 240 grand minimum in debt that you can defer for 6 months and then you got to pay it back. That's life. Okay. You go to college because you want an education. Well, you got to pay it back. I mean, nothing in this world is free. That's just the way it is. You got to pay it back. And that's what I like about it. I told this to somebody the other day when I did the live. That's when the e-learning space came about. You know, all these e-learning platforms. Right now, my e-learning platform, everything's 90% off. Dude, you'll be paying, in some courses, they're like, yeah, you'll be paying $9, $10, maybe cheaper, okay, for the course, for whatever it is. You know what I mean? The whole point is, I mean, obviously, I want to get paid. I mean, that's just the way it is. We work to get paid, but to be able to live and what have you. But yeah, I want to get paid. But you don't got to kill nobody to get paid. Jesus Christ. I mean, come on. Yeah, that's just too much, especially when you go. I mean, I went to UM for a while while I was getting 70% discount because my wife worked there. And I was still paying $3,000 for a class. I was paying $1,010 per credit. Yeah, $3,000. It's $1,010 per credit. That's with the 70%. $1,010 per credit. It was a three-credit class. I was paying $3,000 for a freaking art class. That all we did was majority of the time, the teacher's assistant was there, and then they turned on the TV. And then we had little field trips to the friggin' museum within the school to look at, oh, what does this represent to you? I don't care what it represents to me, man. I'm IT. What am I doing here? And then psychology and psychiatrists. I mean, it's all interesting. That's cool. But there's nothing. I can watch it in the Curiosity Channel. Right? I listen to Jordan Peterson all day, every day. Okay? I learned more from him than I ever did when I was at UM. Okay? No. So there's tons of money. And God forbid you ask a question. And these people that are in these classrooms teaching, supposedly, I remember this one female, she came in 3 minutes late. My God, that art teacher, she went insane on that. Sit down, be quiet, what are you doing? Coming in there yelling at her. It's like, she didn't make a noise. She just walked in the classroom, went to sit down. Ah, she went all crazy. Why are you late? It's like, lady, we're paying your salary. This is not junior high. If I'm late, I'm late. It's up to me to make up the work if I missed it. Okay? Put the freaking syllabus online. I watched Jordan Peterson when he would film his freaking classroom. People walking in late all the time. Way late. He didn't go. He just kept on teaching. Okay? That's it. He didn't go crazy. It's up to the student. You're adults. You get there, you get there. It's the way it is. Well, you know, Laz, if they go to work, they're just teaching you that you have to be on time. We know we got to be on time. We know we got to be on time. Okay? But again, you don't embarrass somebody like that. Using VR and E to pay my degree and search. I don't know what VR and E is. I have no idea what that is. To pay for my degree and search. All right. I mean, whatever you use, if it's helpful, it's good. All right. But it's just insane. Education right now is very expensive. The dropout rates are very high right now. I did an educational thing a long time ago. And it's because people are not motivated. I've seen people when I used to work at the career college that they were dropping out of high school because they're bored out of their mind. These are intelligent kids. They're just bored. And they got their GED and they went to a career college because you're allowed, as long as you got your GED, you can go into a career college and just learn what they need to learn. Now, listen, I want to learn how to repair computers. I don't care about poetry. I just want to learn how to repair computers. Okay? That's what I'll be. I want to be a master at repairing, building, troubleshooting computers. That's it. I want to work. Okay? Has anybody not seen Dirty Jobs before? That was an awesome show. Jobs that nobody wants to do. And there, believe me, there's high-paying jobs out there that nobody wants to do. We all have Instagram and TikTok and all that stuff. I say all the time, would you, for $1 million, would you stay at this lighthouse? Man, yes. I don't care how long you want me to stay there. For a year? I'll stay there for a whole year. $1 million? No problem. By myself? No problem. Okay? Would you? Now, I've seen crazy stuff. Like, I don't know if I would do this. Working on those power lines. And these people are, and it's normally men that are doing these jobs. They're scaling. They're, like, grounded. And they're, like, walking, you know, on these power lines. I don't know if I would do that. I don't know. No. My danger time is over. I'm not doing none of that stuff. So, yeah, you know, right now we have a lot of options. And those of you that have picked this option in networking, there's so many branches that you can go into, whether it be programming, whether it be security, whether it be networking, web development, whatever, or development itself. Network guy enabled VTP one day, and it somehow deleted the entire server of VLAN off the core switch. We turned it off, never used it since. Well, that's If he did that, Rickles, what Cisco recommends, it's a one BTP server. If it's a huge enterprise, you all have different VTP segments, right? But let's say you have a medium-sized network, and you can have, let's say, one VTP segment, one VTP server switch, the rest are client switches, which means he can't mess with the database. That's why you got to be very careful. And before, you know, because what happened is the priority number, when he did that and he implemented other VLANs, the priority number went up, right? Is it called the priority number? Or the incrementation number went up, had a higher number. And then they, even though he's a server switch, then they it wiped out everything else because they all believe that one, and then he sent up an update. But there's steps you take, like creating a domain, creating a VTP domain, a VTP password, making the other computer, the other switches, VTP clients, okay? And then passing a memo. Listen, don't be putting in new VLANs willy-nilly. Then let's have meetings every Monday. Let's discuss the network. Let's all be on the same page. Let's have the documentation. That's why you need to pass on the information. One of the things that I find in the IT field, I mean, it's called networking, isn't it? Let's share information. Let's share information. And that's what I see not happening. That there's very little to no documentation. Nobody wants to share information. All right. And it's like, what, you keep it to yourself? Are you protecting your job? Well, what's going on? You're such a slacker that you don't want to tell nobody how to do things. So you want to make you're forcing somebody to make a mistake, and then you're just going to ream them for it. So don't do that. Don't do that. And that happens. I'm lucky. Man, I've been lucky. When I got hired at Metro, I had the A-team. I was working with the A-team. My God, those guys were good. And they shared everything. And they knew I was about to make a mistake. They slapped me in the back of the head. And, hey, don't do that. I'm like, oh, okay. But that kind of camaraderie and brotherhood is leaving the workforce, right? Now we got to be, hey, guy, don't do that. Okay, it may cause a problem. What is that? No, it's telecommunications. If that site goes down, a lot of people will be phone calls. So you got to make sure that everybody's, you know, you're doing over the shoulder, making sure everybody's good to go and we're on the same page. You have those morning meetings. Hey, what's going on for today? I know we did amongst ourselves. He was our team lead. He would go, this is what's going on today. This is what's got to get done today. You got this, you got this, you got that. Good to go. I'm ready. Boom. Let's get it done. We're motivated, passionate. We love what we do. And if you have questions, you got concerns, ask. Ask. Now you ask, they like, why are you asking that question? Don't you know? Nobody's born knowing everything, man. And that's the problem right now in the workforce. I think that one, OJT needs to come back so you can be trained. You know what I'm saying? You got 90 days. You got 90 days. You better know your stuff in 90 days, or at least be up to par. But, you know, you need to know what you're doing in 90 days. All right, we hired you. You're a CCNA, you're a CCNP. All right, you know the CCNA and CCNP stuff. Okay, we don't have these type of routers. We have a mix of vendors. So these are the vendors that we're using. So ask the questions, get the books. Those 90 days that you get hired, you should be reading everything and anything and looking for any video you can possibly find. Remember, back in my day, I had to go to the library. Okay, the library. In order to get information. And then, you know, there was now YouTube and Google and all these things that all is there. Now you got AI. I mean, my God, ask it. Google, you just type something in it. Oh, well, the EIGRP routing protocol, blah, 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 blah. It just spills that everything out for you. So if you don't know something right now, you don't, and you come unprepared to an interview, that's on you. But if you come prepared to an interview, you answer the questions to your best of your ability, okay? 90, 95% to the best of your ability, and they still don't hire you, and you are professional, and you're certain, you know, you're, you know, friendly, but you were professional. You kept everything. You said, listen, you were honest and ethical. And you said, listen, I don't know that. I've never ran into that issue before. But, you know, now that I know you made me aware of this, I appreciate that because I will make sure that I will find out. And that's just the way I am. If I don't know something, then until I learn it, I don't stop. And these are the people that need to get hired. But unfortunately, those are not the people that are being hired. The people that are being hired are the ones that are just like, hey, what's up, buddy? How you doing? Hey, Kevin, let's go play pool after work. Yeah, yeah. Let's grab a beer. Oh, it's cool. Awesome. And then everything's jacked up. But that's okay. Things will change soon enough. But yeah, so labbing is important for anything. If you're doing networking, pure hardcore networking, Cisco, Network Plus, you know, starting, let's say you're starting from the ground up, Network Plus, and moving on up, and it's all Packet Tracer is your tool. I've used Packet Tracer for certain things in CCNP when I first started, because it does zone-based firewalls. How about that? It does BGP, eBGP, but it does it. Okay, so you can go ahead and use it for a lot of things. But it seems that only instructors that work, and certain instructors in career colleges, pretty much all the instructors in technical schools know how to use the Packet Tracer. But you got these professors in these mainstream colleges have no clue as to what they're doing in the Packet Tracer. And a lot of them, if not all of them, well, not all of them, because I've seen others that are using the latest Packet Tracer, but they're using it wrong. And then they're using Packet Tracer 6.2. Really? And it's only one person, one computer. Nobody else, they don't save anything. So you can't do a copy run start or WR or anything like that. You can't. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. And now I know. See, that's what I love about doing what I do. Because I get all these feedback from students, emails, phone calls, you know, or when they're with me in the boot camps or a course, whatever, tutoring in my platform. All right. They tell me, or they show me, hey man, I'm gonna send you this. Okay, cool. This is what we're doing. All right. What is this? I mean, I know what I'm looking at, so I fix it, and then I explain it, and then I make them do it, whatever the case may be. You know what I mean? But it's like I help them out. So, I appreciate the patronage, but if you're already paying thousands of dollars to a school, man, I know I was that student. I raised my hand. I was respectful. I raised my hand. What is this? What is this? What is this? What is this? And then either they told me I'll get back to you on that, which they did, or they just completely ignored me. Does the Packet Tracer have .1x authentication on switches? I don't think so. I don't think so. I don't think I've ever done. Well, you have it on the wireless. On the wireless, you will do .1x for radius. You will do that. You will do .1x. So yeah. So it says Packet Tracer. I don't know wireless. I've done it for the wireless controllers. I've done that. Yep. We use the pre-share key first, and then we change it to radius. Where we take out the pre-share key and use .1x. So sure does. So it's minimal what you can do in those wireless controllers, but I have a lab for the wireless controllers in Packet Tracer, okay, that you can do. So it's, I enjoy it. Maybe I think that's the difference, whether you're working, because we keep saying job. I like career better, okay? When I go out there, if I'm looking for something, I always say career, before I even got into IT, and it got me into trouble. I was at a point in my life, it was hard. And I was applying as a dishwasher. Check it out. As a dishwasher in Chili's. And the interviewer said, so what is your goal? Well, my goal is to get a career, here in the restaurant business. I can start my way here as a dishwasher and work my way up, up the ladder, however far that may take me. Oh, no, you're too astute. Those were his words. You're too astute. I'm sorry. You may take my job. He didn't say that, but that's what he's saying. Oh, no, you don't belong here. I wouldn't want you doing dishes because, you get a better job, you'll leave in a second. So, bro, I got to pay my bills. I got to feed my family. Give me a job. You know what I mean? So the person that got that help desk, great. Have fun. If it's outsourced help desk, enjoy it. Learn from it. Build a database of knowledge. All things to get a JOB, and then, you know, and hopefully in what we studied, and then make a career. And this is where I think a lot of students make a mistake, where you get conned in going into college, and they tell you, no, you need to take, I'll use this example. You need to get criminal justice, you need to get your degree in criminal justice and international relations. You'll be working with the police, you can work in the White House, you can do all this stuff. They give you, they paint a pretty picture. And then you go through all these courses, you don't do the ride-alongs, you don't do all these things because you don't have the time. You got 4 years, you gotta be making money, okay? And then not all of us were born with a silver spoon in our mouth. We gotta work for a living. And then when you get out, that degree don't mean squat. That particular degree doesn't mean anything. Good luck. Good luck to you. I rather, which I did, okay, I had my mouse, because that thing's old, had my mouse. I knew Excel. I took the Excel, Word, PowerPoint, Access. I took all those four, and I learned how to type. I bought the typing, well, my wife bought it for me, the typing instructor. And I went from typing one word a minute or one word an hour to friggin' 90 words a minute. Okay. So that's just what I did. And then they didn't want to hire me in an office. Talk about being picky and choosy, not to say certain words. Okay. They didn't want to see this face in the front desk. Okay. Hey, lads, this is Javar. What's up, Javar? Good to see you, brother. How's everything? What do you need? Say it now. Oh, just good to see. Okay. Good to see you too, man. But yeah, this video was really just, I guess, to make the PhDs, these college professors, make them use the packet tracer correctly, give better instructions. If they're going to give instructions, give better instructions. Because people tell me, hey, Lars, can you put some instructions? I'm like, okay. I put this is your network ID. I need connectivity with EIGRP or OSPF, whatever the case may be. And you need to, let's say they already got in the CCNP, you need to redistribute. This is what you need to do. That's it. And make sure you redistribute between OSPF and BGP. Done. Those are your instructions. Go ahead. That's it. I give you minimal things. You need to be able to look at a topology and say, okay, these are two lines. Last has a port channel one, port channel two, port channel three. There's an IP address, or we're doing ether channel layer three. Layer three ether channel. Okay, so now I do layer three ether channel. I'm not going to give you directions. Well, you go here and use this username and password, and then go here and do this, because that's how these college professors get you. Oh, see, this is what I did on one of these things. I made fun, because I know HTML, so I went to HTML and I put some, you know, Batman phrase or something on there just to mess around, because it's like, come on. You know what I mean? It's like, don't tell me what, tell me to put a password. Okay. Make sure you put in your privilege mode passwords. Make sure that your console and your console and your VTY lines are protected. I can see that. Okay. Do that. Now say, well, your password has to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, asterisk, forward slash, A, B, C, D. You know, it's like, why? Why? That's no, just tell me that I need to secure my router. How about that? I need to secure it using what's available to me. And then if you want me to do access list, tell me, hey, you need to do an access list that does X, Y, and Z. How long did it take you to get hired from dishwasher to your first networking job? Years, brother, years. Because I started working for myself first. I made up these little stupid little cards and I passed them out and I started doing like dentist office and stuff like that, you know, a little 3-6 computers, you know, network type of thing. And then I got to work for the county and I was doing, again, applications. I first started not in networking, but as an applications instructor. I literally taught Excel, PowerPoint, all that stuff. And New Horizons is where I worked at. And that was If it was another application, it was I got to teach Windows 98, was it? And then from there is it was still just doing side jobs and then like saying multiple jobs, right? And then I got my shot at it in a career college. No, not true. Before I got the career college, I went to Palm Beach Community College as an adjunct instructor. I got to teach Windows 2000 server there. And then I got to the career college and I was teaching A+. I hated life for 2 years because I hate A+ with a passion. I just don't like it. And then from there, I got the opportunity to start teaching networking. So, and then that's when I did my YouTube channel and I started doing contracts on the side, whether it was either teaching or doing, which was cool. But I like the teaching part of it, really. I like more the teaching part. And I guess, honestly, if I'm going to be completely honest, full-time job was when I went to Metro PCS, telecommunications, which was nothing when I was doing the CCNA. So it was years for me, but I took the long road. Because not until I met my wife, my present wife, that tomorrow will be April 12th, which will be make 25 years that we've been together. It's not our wedding anniversary, but it's the day we met. And since the day we met, we've never been apart. 25 years. Our wedding anniversary is in September 10th. Because we got married September 10th, 1999. But tomorrow makes 25 years that we've been together. But it was her that actually got me into this. Because I didn't get the job as a dishwasher because I was too astute. But I, warehousing, surveying, construction, security guard. I can take you on a tour in Miami and tell you I worked there, I worked there, I worked there, I worked there, I worked there. Hell, I started working, full-time working at the age of 16 at Burger King. I was getting paid $3.10 an hour. Okay, so these people that are crying now in California, they're getting paid $20 an hour for flipping burgers. I was getting paid $3.10 an hour. But those minimum wage jobs are meant for kids. They're not meant for adults, even though there were adults working there at that minimum wage, but they had their social security and what have you, all right? And they maybe had multiple jobs, as you said. That's just the way it is. Why do I like teaching? Oh, man, it is freaking awesome when I see somebody's light bulb go off. When somebody comes in not knowing how to do something, and then they're like, just running through it like they've been doing it all their lives. I remember my first course, full-blown course in Udemy, which was CCNA. I had one student that stood out above all. And when I went to the convention, he actually spoke and they put him up there and they said, hey, thanks to Laz, I got my CCNA. He was in Kenya. So as an educator, I like the fact that I'm able to help people to change. It may sound, you can call it corny if you want, but it's true, is because I can help you gain that, you know, grasp that goal that you want, better your life, right? Because you want to become a network engineer, you want to get that Cisco certification, that's going to take you to the next level. You want to take that Security Plus, whatever it is that I teach, right? It's going to take you to that next level. So, and that's what I like about it. Seeing the results, seeing people actually, you know, making it, being successful. That is motivation to me. That's why I've been doing it for over the past 20 years. I'm not tired. I like it. I'm passionate. It's awesome. When somebody says, hey, last thanks, bro. What you said really helped me pass the cert. Hey, man, I got that new position. Thank you, man. And a lot of people give me props for that. And it's like, it's not only me, it's also you. I mean, I can show you how to do it. I can try to put you in that path, but you got to want it as well. So it's a two-way street. And believe me, also, I have students all around the world. I knew this, a Cuban. Think about that, in Finland. I told my parents, get to Wasai. What are you doing there? How did you get to Finland? All right. He is in Finland. I know people in England, obviously. I know people. Where was this place? This one guy. Romania. I have several students in Romania. One of my courses is in freaking Russia. They dubbed it. I mean, I've being able to communicate people in Australia, being able to communicate with people around the world, which is awesome, which a professor can do in a classroom. It's just where a student comes there. That's it. I'm able to talk to people throughout the world, which is awesome. And I can get their take on things. Okay. I've talked to many security experts that wanted to know about networking. They told me, no, Laz, look, because I used to make fun of, let's say, remarks in ACLs. And they go, no, Laz, that's important, because when they audit you, they want to know exactly what this is and that, and the timestamp. I said, oh, really? You're going to test people on how to set up the clock? And they told me, no, Laz, that's important. The clock, this, that, the other thing. So I get feedback. It's a back and forth. I love it. I love it. Getting to talk to, that's why you see me doing a lot of lives. That's why I'm doing, you know, the workshops, live online boot camps. I like it. I do courses. Yeah, I've done it more before. Now I'm more into I want to have conversations. I want people to ask questions. I want people to tell me, hey, Laz, this is what's really going on. I'm like, oh, cool. Okay. So it's, and that I can, you guys can make me a better instructor, a better educator by telling me all these things. Hey, Laz, we don't do that anymore. Or I should, and then I will probably tell you, hey, listen, you should be doing that because ABC. And we can have that conversation back and forth. Believe me, I'm known in certain workshops. I say it's only going to be 3 hours. I'm there for 4 hours sometimes. I have one student. She told me, when is the workshop over? Because I just go over sometimes. All right. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes it's right at 3 hours. Or sometimes it means a little less if you grasp the concept and all that. But it all depends. That's why I tell you guys, if you have me live, here I am. Ask all the questions you need to ask, because I want to make sure that you understand this. This is not rocket science. It really is not. It really is not. And the biggest kryptonite for everybody is IP addressing. And I have yet to find, and my God, my book is out there. The I don't know if you guys have it already. I have it somewhere right here. Nah. In my IPv4 book, it should be standard reading in every freaking college. So you learn how to do things the easy way. Because it only takes once for me to show somebody how to do my way of subnetting, and they're like, oh, what? My teacher took 6 boards to do it. So that's the whole thing. I just enjoy it a lot. I enjoy it a lot. Okay. I really, really do. And I get a lot from it. And especially when you guys get certified, you guys got that new job or that promotion or whatever. That makes me happy. That it really, really does. That when I finish a workshop, I say, hey man, we did good, or I get good feedback. Or even if I get, hey lads, you forgot to do this. I'm like, oh, okay. You know what I mean? And that's what I tell everybody. If Javar is still here, I know he's working, but he can tell you. I tell everybody, keep me honest. Make sure that I'm doing make sure, because I'm the typo king. I make typos. I go too fast. All right. But it just takes dedication. All right. And if you put your head down and you keep going forward, you'll do it. It won't take you years like it took me. All right. I needed to be married to this woman who's amazing in order to be who I am right now. And I'm blessed to be with both of my wife and my stepdaughter. Both of them are amazing. They're a hell of a team players, and they always keep me honest and on board. So that's all you got to do. That's it. But I'll leave you with this. All right. So PhDs, I hope you listened up to what I said. Okay. Please learn how to use the packet tracer. And if you're going to give good instruction, give good instruction. Remember, this thing has been, what is this? Going around and around. The coupon Eclipse. Go to globed.net. All self-paced courses for the next 72 hours are 90% off for 72 hours. 90% off. Okay. So there's no reason why you can't get it. So if you're going to get your CCMP, get the, I think I have a CCMP in there. CCMP bootcamp in there that you can download. Those are 4-hour videos. Okay. So, or 3.5, whatever it is, they're there. Okay. So you can go ahead and get those. But everything is there that you need. So go to GlobeEd, check it out. Subscribe to GlobeEd so you know when new things I do. I update my courses every so often so you know when the updates are there. So subscribe to GlobeEd. If you're new here, subscribe to my channel. All right, it helps me out. And then, you know, I'm starting to put more I'm starting to put more videos. Okay. So just keep it going. Just keep it going. All right. So take advantage of the promotion right now. There's only 72 hours in it and you get 90% off. Okay. And next Wednesday, be ready. I'll be putting it up probably on Monday again. It's going to be multiple named EIGRP ASs. So it's going to be, instead of just doing single EIGRP AS, it's going to be a multiple ASs using named EIGRP. It's going to be interesting. All right, everyone. Thank you for taking time out during your busy day to be in this live. And then I'll see you guys hopefully soon again. Thank you, Mr. Jabbar. Appreciate it, brother. You guys take care. Be safe, stay strong, stay motivated.